The functioning of this mysterious organ that we call the brain, that determines all the psychological, mental capacities of humans, and at the end is responsible for cultural evolution, so it's constitutive for mankind. And what I'm so much fascinated about is that our intuition is not able to grasp the processes, the mechanistic processes that are realized by nature in our brains. And I consider this a conundrum, because after all, it's this machinery that makes us think and recognize, perceive, and it's unable to perceive itself in the way in which we can describe it from a third-person perspective as a neuroscientist. And what we see more and more, and this is something I would like to convey to the public in particular, is the extreme complexity of this system and the ingeniosity of evolution that has brought forth this system, because it transcends our ability to imagine. It's a little bit like physics that got confronted with the riddles of quantum physics or the universe, where you are confronted with dimensions that are not intuitively plausible, not imaginable. You can deduce them mathematically, perhaps. And something similar happens with the brain in the moment. We face a degree of complexity and dynamics of a very high degree of dimensionality that we cannot imagine. And still, we use this apparatus in order to talk, perceive, and be what we are.
So I think one of the beauty of our encounter that really got us inspired and happy to discuss together for a number of years, I think 8 years altogether, was that there's a kind of very interesting complementarity between what Wolf said and the first-person experience, which is to describe from the inside what the person who looks within the mind and consciousness and experience, basically, subjective experience, how, first of all, what is the nature of that subjective experience, how far we can go in at least deepening that very primary experience, and then how we can attempt to sort of relate both the first person and the third person perspective, sometimes successfully, sometimes that seems to be hard to reconcile, but nevertheless, this is one of the most sort of enriching type of discussion that we can have to try to match the purely experiential approach and the one that describes the workings of the brain.
You know, in a sense, you have two experts here. and this may also answer the question, why Buddhism, why Mathieu? Because philosophy, this tradition, has cultivated introspection and the science of the mind, as they call it. Yes. So the analytical skills to explore yourself. And Buddhist contemplatives are experts in this art. And while we, the neuroscientists, as all the other scientists, we are down-to-earth analyzers of something that is outside of us. And so there, you have two experts here, one for the third-person perspective and one for the first-person perspective. And this is what got us going, because we had this epistemic curiosity. To which extent is what Mathieu discovers when he sits and analyzes himself about his brain and his psyche and his human constitution, to which extent is this compatible with what neuroscience tells us and tells him about the functioning of the brain? And as you can see in the book, certain things match, others don't. Well, matching points are certainly our notion of how our perception works. Both Mathieu and the Buddhist, as representative of Buddhist philosophy, they consider the outer world as not having properties by itself, but being assigned properties, being constructed by your perception. And neuroscience posits exactly the same. There are sensory signals from the outer world, physical, chemical signals, but what creates your perception and your, let me say, illusion of there being a real world in the sense of reality, this is a construction of your brain. And here in this case, we are absolutely d'accord. We have the same, came to the same conclusion. If you consider that on the retina of your eye, all you have is a two-dimensional distribution of electromagnetic waves that differ a little bit in wavelength and intensity. And what your brain extracts from this is all the richness of the visual environment that you experience, which is fantastic. You subdivide it into objects, into motion, into color. You add emotional connotations to it. You can form categories. All this is a synthetic achievement of your brain on the basis of just very sparse sensory information. And this is true for all senses. So the world around us, we construct it. We decide what an object is. We decide about dimensions, about three dimensions. Some of it matches with physical reality. Some of it doesn't at all. So in addition, we perceive only a very, very small segment of the possible signals that are available out there. But still we have the impression all we perceive is all there is.
We see the world, yes.
Which is, of course, another illusion. So we stumble from one illusion into the other, believing in our senses, believing in our interpretations, taking them for real. And the great virtue of this philosophy is don't trust it. Be careful. These may be interpretations, may not be the absolute truth.
Yes, so from an experiential point of view, we also say there's a theory of perception in Buddhism, which is quite remarkable for a philosophy or a spirituality, because there's not many other religions that offer a sophisticated theory of perception, that we never actually perceive the world as it is. Because first there's the organs, the eye, and then there is the raw signal that goes to the brain, and then there's the mental image that is created. So by then, the reality has changed naturally, because nothing stays the same. So that's one thing. And the second thing that Buddhism says is we constantly superimpose to reality our own, due to our tendency, our past experience, and we separate things in some are being beautiful or ugly or pleasant or unpleasant, but all that are projections of our construction of our mind projected onto reality. But nevertheless, even though we know that we're not perceiving the so-called reality as it is through perception, but Buddhism contends that through analytical approach, we can at least ascertain that all phenomena are impermanent, that they are interdependent, they are devoid of intrinsic realities as defined as being something and that's it, or in an autonomous way. So there's a contention that this is nothing to do with sensory perception, but the analytical approach of reality can untangle some of the characteristics of reality that are not dependent on what evolution has equipped us to function in the world. If you analyze phenomena and find out that they are impermanent, you know, basically a valid cognition cannot be taken at fault. I mean, you would not be able to point out as something that is truly permanent anywhere in the universe. I mean, that's always been the same and will always be the same. That's not part of reality. So that's something you can have confidence in. And that's nothing to do with the filters of your perception, the reconstruction of the perceived reality, because this is more about some basic facts about outer reality.